Put your hands up! Woo-hoo-hoo, that was wicked!
Willard, please, calm down. I'm only trying to help here. He wouldn't listen to me. Even Winona agreed that selling off the assets was the only way not to lose everything. Yet he refused to hear a word of it from either of us. The last three films had bankrupted the company, and the blood-sucking debt collectors had come to collect, one way or another.
And fortune, the ready to expand your mind. Back off, man!
My mother died when I was 6 years old. Her funeral would be the first and last time I'd ever see my father cry.
Fate is in your hands.
Spread love, not hate. Ooh, mind blowing. Hey, hey, hey! You are ripping my beads, deadhead! Hey, a little something extra never hurt.
Step forward and make your wish.
Rated D for dead.
I wanted to make it big, but not by lying on my back. I'd heard about how creepy Wyler could be from a few other actresses, but when he started getting overly touchy-feely, I knew there was going to be trouble. I had repeatedly tried to brush him off, or keep others on set with me.
Ugh! you, furball!
His jealousy and desire for her would be the death of me. Getting cast in the film alongside Brittany Maxey, that was a dream come true. She was an absolutely beautiful Hollywood star on the rise, and Wyler's films, they were the stuff of legend. I thought my career was going to blast off. I'd worked for Mr. Wyler for some time before meeting Luna. But when I did, I knew she was the one. We dated in secret for about a year before letting her father in on it. Talk about a tense day. He wouldn't allow me to give her my name. Instead, I was to hyphenate mine with his. That was the only way he'd provide his blessing. Matthew Mason Wyler. I felt like an idiot.
kids we made together? We're some of the best, I tell you.
I give
up. You can't trust nobody in show business anymore.
I'd always wanted to know how Willard Wyler got his movies to look so real. For weeks, I had been feverishly waiting our class trip to Mr. Wyler's theater. This was the man, the myth, the legend. This was Willard Wyler we were talking about here.
When SMG stands for sexy motherfucking gun.
Hey, you are ripping my beads, deadhead!
All right, looking for candy.
When I got the call for the job, I had just spent my last...
candy that goes boom.
I'd have never taken the job if I knew this thing was gonna happen. Had me sleeping with the fishes. It was supposed to be a regular job. Follow this girl around, report back on who she's seeing, where she's going. You know, typical paranoid husband-boyfriend stuff. Weird part is, this job pays big. Real big. First couple of nights, nothing. Then I start seeing this guy come around. Young guy with a long beard. So I snap a couple of photos. Turns out he's her co-star on this new flick Wyla's directing. When I delivered the second round of photos to Wyla, well, he about blew a gasket. He's going on and on about this broad. He's got a ding for her or something. Pulls out a bottle of something spicy and asks me if I want a drink. So I say, sure, why not?
Ow, hands off the candy! Ow!
Willard, please, calm down. I'm only trying to help here. He wouldn't listen to me. Even Winona agreed that selling off the assets was the only way not to lose everything. Yet he refused to hear a word of it from either of us. The last three films had bankrupted the company, and the blood-sucking debt collectors had come to collect, one way or another. Bronze toad struck me across the back of my neck, and I blacked out immediately. Awakening in the theater was unexpected, but ending up inside Rave in the Redwoods was beyond my wildest imagination. I thought I'd been drugged, but the pain I felt from the movie slasher's blade was all too real.
When we showed up at the theater, he said we'd just be a minute, but this would be my big chance to meet the famous Willard Wyla. I mean, it was one thing working on one of his movies, but I was pretty much geeking out when he said I'd be meeting the man in the flesh. Mr. Wyla seemed pissed off right from the get-go. Neither man seemed to even care that I was just standing there watching him bicker like two school kids. When the lights went out, I didn't think anything of it, but when that screen opened up, I just about shit my pants, literally. Mr. Hudson tried to save me, but that dude in the mask just tossed him around like a rag doll. The pain I felt right after my legs were hacked off was real intense. By the time my body hit the dirt, I was in shock. I didn't even feel anything else. I just laid there on the ground, in and out of consciousness. Watching him slowly mutilate Mr. Hudson's body until the darkness came over me. I just want to go home.
Brittany was... she was a workhorse. She wanted to rehearse all the time. But our rehearsals turned into late dinners, which turned into long weekends, which turned into much more than I had ever bargained for. We both lived our separate lives apart. But when we were together, we were a couple in love. We always played it safe, because we knew the tabloids would have a field day. The photos still turned up. The afternoon they did, I received a message that I was to see Mr. Wyler in his trailer immediately. The photos he threw on the desk in front of me. They were going to end my marriage. Possibly damage the film, and likely my career. Willard assured me that he could make this all go away, but that I was not to see Miss Maxey any further, unless on set. I swore I'd break it off immediately, and left his trailer. I'd seen Willard get flirty with girls on the set, but he had a real hard-on for Brittany.
My father's company was going under, and he wouldn't listen to anyone. Not even me. Travis had warned him, but he didn't care. My father would rather watch it all burn than be sold to someone else. I knew I had to go my own way, and allow him to go his. His legacy was his own, not mine to maintain. With Matthew and I both ready to venture into something of our own, we set forth with a plan to establish our own film company. Within a couple of months, we were financed, and everything was ready to move forward. I knew breaking the news to my father wasn't exactly going to be easy, but the band-aid had to come off. The scolding we received after we told him about the company was terrifying. He accused us of betraying him and cursed us both out. I had never once in my life seen my father so violently angry. He stormed out of the theater, screaming incoherently. When we arrived in the Redwoods film, the shock nearly killed me. I couldn't believe my own father had sold his soul and cast Matthew and I away into the oblivion of this film. We sought refuge on an island, and pled with the man on the island to help us, but he turned us away. When I was first attacked, Matthew tried to stop him, but he was too strong for either of us. I tried to get away, but it tore into my flesh with its blade. My last thoughts were of my husband, and the child I had yet to tell him we had conceived. I'm so very sorry, Matthew. I love you.
How could you kill your own daughter?
When Winona told me she wanted to break away from her father and create a name for herself, I was hesitant, but supportive. I told her he was gonna kill us when he found out about the children's film company, but I never thought in a million years that he'd actually go through with it. A vortex that lifted us off our feet and into the screen looked like something right out of Willard's films. Winona was pulled through first, but I wasn't far behind her. As unbelievable as it were, there we stood, in the cabin within his wretched film. We made our escape from the monsters surrounding the cabin and happened upon the small island at the lake center. Oh. We pleaded with Mr. Smith on the island to let us into his cabin, but he accused us of being in on this entire fiasco with Willard. Coincidentally, on the way back to the shore, we overheard his screams. But whatever had killed him had now turned its attention to us. The splasher attacked Winona first. I tried to defend her, but I was immediately incapacitated. While I lay helplessly bleeding, nearly unconscious, the final sounds I would ever hear were over Winona's screams. I'm so sorry. I love her.
Willard, how could you?
were all in the theater, the magic show began. Every kid from my theater class had been transported with me into the classic film, Rave in the Redwoods, right into the scene where the zombie lumberjacks invade the rave. The zombies chewed on just about everybody. And anyone that didn't get chewed on got chopped up by that masked freak. What really pisses me off is knowing he was a freaking soul pimp. He actually sold us off to this jerk, and for what? You think you're getting to meet a lifetime idol, and the next thing you know, your professor is selling your soul for eternal life or something. I mean, if I had known I was going to end up in this film at the beginning of a semester, I'd have studied chemistry instead. I should have known the invitation to the theater for an early screening of the work in progress was BS. What I received in the theater was a stack of photos of me with Jacob Geiger, my co-star. This creep had me followed and was acting like some demented, upset boyfriend. When I tried to leave, he pushed me down into the chair and told me he had one last thing to show me. I have no idea how it happened, but when I saw the cabin, and I was back in makeup and costume, I thought I'd lost my mind. The film was nothing like the set. It was somehow real. And so was the masked killer that was running around on the loose. I remember the mask, the coldness of it as my hands pressed against it, trying to free myself from the killer's grasp while he plunged his blade into my stomach. I was dead within moments of the first puncture. Please tell me this isn't my final curtain call.
Willard Wyler was polite and accommodating initially, but when I attempted to explain the tribe's firm position on the matter, he would hear none of it. When that movie screen lit up and the wind began, I thought there were some kind of parlor tricks trying to frighten me at first. But when I was in the air flying into the screen, it was all too real. The masked monster and the undead that I saw on screen while in the theater were hunting me through the forest. I ran as fast as I could, but I never made it very far. The blade of my assailant went through my neck and into the tree I was resting against. For a split second, I could see my lifeless body slumped to the floor without my head. May the spirits of my ancestors protect me.
Ow!
I was sent on behalf of the Northern Lakes Tribunal Council. Mr. Wyler's filming company had requested permission to return to our land to film another of his movies. The message I was to deliver was that he was no longer welcomed by the tribes after irreparable damage to a sacred ritual site had taken place during his previous shoots. Any attempt to push the filming permit through was to be met with a unified tribal protest. Me and the crew, we was working in good faith without pay for a month. And most of these kids got families, if you know what I mean. When I tried to talk to him on set, the horny old bastard's got one of these young actresses pinned up. He sees me and gets all worked up and says, we should talk it over at his theater after the shift since he's, you know, busy. So I headed straight over that night to get to the bottom of this little monetary problem I had.
Willard's running at the mouth, telling me to forget what I saw with the girl that morning and all this talk about making deals with some guy. Tells me to just wait until this other deal gets all settled. All I knew was we made a deal, and it was only right that he kept his side of the damn thing. Well, that rat bastard pulled some voodoo shit on me. Next thing I know, I got some damn psychopathic mascot chopping me and my crewman Danny Wapner into pieces in the middle of the forest. Poor kid. I was just giving him a lift home that night and the theater was on the way. Go figure.